One of the creepiest solutions to the Fermi Paradox is that there is simply no one out there. To paraphrase Arthur C. Clarke, there either is someone out there or there isn't, and both are equally terrifying. One argument, of course, is that intelligent life is simply incredibly rare and too distant on average to be detected. But Clarke's words may have been an understatement in that there could also be a very artificial reason for why we see no one out there, in the form of some future technology so devastating and powerful that no one in the universe survives its development, where such technology could come about without anyone realizing its true potential until it's too late. There are two forms of this kind of futurism and speculation. One is in thinking about the worst of the two. This is the unknown black swan technology that on its face seems beneficial and desirable, but has an unforeseen side effect that proves fatal to a civilization. We know this type of problem already. We as humans have developed many technologies that seemed beneficial and desirable at the beginning, but only to find out that they had unforeseen side effects that didn't yet prove fatal, but certainly proved to be a huge problem. One of these is plastic. There was a time where plastic was seen as, and marketed as, a superior product to anything that came before it, like glass or ceramics. And in a sense, it was, in some ways, superior. And indeed, we still use it extensively, of course. But we've had to devise rather imperfect ways of recycling it, in part to deal with the huge amounts of it we produce. We still end up dumping large amounts of it into the environment, however. Landfills are rather expensive, and so on. But what no one foresaw in the early days of plastic was the effects it would have on wildlife, or that a giant vortex in an ocean would collect it up, or that it would become in some instances a choke hazard, or that burning it to get rid of it would be a bad idea all around. Now we have to mitigate the effects of plastics by formulating ways to make them infinitely recyclable through advanced chemistry, which is progressing, but is still imperfect. But sometimes these kinds of inventions aren't always as readily evident as something like run-of-the-mill plastic, but just as potentially damaging. Take the chemical perfluorooctane sulfonic acid. This is an artificially produced chemical, originally designed to protect fabric from water and stains, and it worked quite well. Then they started finding it inside the human body and the environment. It turns out that this human-made chemical just doesn't degrade and persists in the environment very long term. The levels found in humans and wildlife in countries that have stopped using this chemical are dropping, not so in ones that still do. Other inventions that would make the list are medications that years later were found not to be quite the miracle drugs they were once thought to be, or the burning of fossil fuels, or what to do with nuclear waste and dead batteries and so on. The point is, sometimes technology can go wrong in ways that weren't largely predicted when those technologies made their debut. But here's the problem. The risk of this may be exponential, in that the more advanced your technology is, the more dangerous it could turn out to be without the inventor ever even knowing what the eventual side effects would end up being. But the other form of this kind of futurism is where we have technologies that we know the risks and we pursue, but often public perception of them can be rather problematic. They might be good and might be necessary, but might also be made better than in previous incarnations and can still prove to be useful and safe. But then there are technologies where we know the risks, but haven't entirely explored the realities yet, at least to their furthest extent. That could have unforeseen side effects, or even where foreseen side effects could be much worse than most people even in the industry currently imagine. Of course, I speak of artificial intelligence. There are two arguments regarding artificial intelligence, one pro and one con, on the risks. On the con side, the first is that it cannot ever approach or equal human intelligence, and more importantly, things like common sense and a computer's ability of being able to weed through all of the stimuli one receives in life and make sense of it. The other is the dangerous pro side, that it will achieve that and become extraordinarily dangerous in an immortal dictator sort of way. You'll find variations of both arguments raging throughout the debate on artificial intelligence. In other words, no one really knows how the development of AI will turn out. On the side that artificial intelligence will never be a threat, The case is usually made that in our current technological state, computers and their abilities are far from a true AI danger, as envisioned in science fiction. Typically, AI and machine learning are very specific technologies. They aren't generalized, and are designed to perform specific tasks by a human. They are essentially advanced tools that can to some degree improve themselves, but only to a certain extent. And there are indeed examples where technology has effectively frozen at its most utilitarian state, and while it could go further, it usually doesn't due to practicality. An example here would be the ship. There was a time when the faster you could get a ship to go, the better. Engines accomplished this above and beyond sail, and the age of sail is mostly over, though of course sailing ships still exist. But take a modern aircraft carrier. A modern US Navy aircraft carrier doesn't move all that much faster than a World War II battleship. It could, but it doesn't have to. There are just practical limits on what you can do, even though we can make faster ships than current aircraft carriers. Or take aircraft themselves. Sure, you could replace all commercial aircraft with Concorde-like supersonic jets, but factors limit the utility of doing so. For this reason, it may be that we never pursue advanced superintelligent AI. We could, but there's simply no need, so we never do. This may work for alien civilizations as well. There may be possible technologies they could pursue, but they simply don't because there isn't a utility in doing so. Yes, it's possible to build a giant space laser that can destroy a planet, but why do so if you don't need to? But as biological creatures ourselves, we could build very dangerous technologies that can severely damage a planet. So could aliens. The other side of the argument is that AI is inherently dangerous. This is the apocalyptic view often depicted in science fiction, such as my own book Supermind, where an artificial intelligence is either designed to be truly generalized like a living creature, or it makes itself generalized through constantly improving itself until it achieves superintelligence, possibly before we were even aware that it was emerging. The idea of superintelligence is rather simple. It's where an entity, whether a machine or biological, supersedes the intelligence of humans in general. On the biological side, one can imagine augmented human brains that make use of technology to increase their capacity for intelligence. In a machine, this is done simply by making a machine that either is smarter than we are, or makes itself smarter than we are. For biological superintelligence, we're already working in that direction with brain-to-computer interfaces, and still somewhat rudimentary implants, usually for medical purposes. But it may eventually be the case where things like entire college degrees can be implanted and accessed directly by the brain. The question here, of course, is if we really want to start messing with the human brain in that way, or keep things natural, or just make ourselves smarter than our computers are getting. One can also envision things like augmented human brains getting hacked, or the person receiving the implant completely changing in personality entirely. Imagine an entire society of such augmented humans and how that might work. One possible path for biological augmentation being useful is in space exploration. We're very delicate, and one can envision all sorts of Borg-like implants that could make us more resistant to the effects of living and working in space, including superintelligence. But does that constitute a complete change in the nature of humanity? Could that group of augmented people still define themselves as Homo sapiens? While we still define people with medical implants, so you don't become something else when you get a hip replacement, for example, there does eventually seem to be a line where there just isn't enough human left in an augmented person to define them as fully human. That alone could be said, in a certain sense, to be the destruction of a previous wholly biological civilization, giving rise to a new species with a technological, biological hybrid civilization, perhaps very different from the one that spawned it. On the machine end, superintelligence is outright scary, but also a lot less likely. Our computers and technology are nothing close to this yet, but if technology continues to advance, say into an age of quantum computing, machines could grow eerily intelligent. Indeed, they already are, but they are still just carrying out tasks that they were designed for. They are not thinking and living for themselves. If a generalized AI could achieve that level of existence, true consciousness, it may do unpredictable things that lead to the destruction of the civilization that created it, if they aren't careful to manage it. But there are a lot of what-ifs involved with that idea. One, it assumes that we can make computers that powerful. There's no guarantee we can. Second, it assumes that we would. We may not, because of the ethical questions involved, but also enormous cost, lack of utility, and a sense for how dangerous something like that might be. After all, does it seem like a good idea to intentionally make something smarter than you are? It may never seem like a good idea to anyone. Or, on the other hand, it may be forced into existence because of some military use, leading to multiple such AIs in various nation-states. That, too, could easily lead to the destruction of an alien civilization. Then we come to the wild card, where a seemingly innocuous but very capable computer starts a cycle of learning and self-improvement that leads it to the same end without anyone realizing it's happening. Such an emergence could be disastrous and lead to the extinction of the species that created it. But that's not the only thing it could do. It could just as easily conclude that there's no point to existence and shut itself down. And all civilizations survive the hurdle, scratching their heads, wondering why computers invariably turn themselves off when they get to a certain level of high complexity. Or it might devise a way to launch itself into space, say goodbye to the civilization that created it, and head out to find the coldest part of the galaxy it could find in order to compute more efficiently. On the other hand, there may be ways for species in the universe messing with these technologies to flirt with disaster, but avert it. One could imagine putting such an intelligent AI into a virtual world to see what it does virtually before unleashing it on society, for example. But that brings up the question of seemingly benign artificial intelligences that know they're being subjected to a simulation, behaving themselves until brought into the actual reality, and then turning on its creators. After all, there's nothing more patient than a computer. But artificial intelligence is only part of the equation in this solution to the Fermi Paradox. There are also other technologies that could prove to be the extinction factor for alien civilizations. Another is the potentially awesome power of nanotechnology. We are already flirting with this technology with our ever-shrinking devices. What a modern smartphone can do in the palm of your hand is now greater than what a computer in a university in the 1950s could do. Yet it took up the space of an entire building. Indeed, computers in those days not only took up a building, but in at least one case literally heated the building. No heating system required. And there is no question of the power of having a computer with internet access that can fit in your pocket. It's revolutionized the world, to the point that our devices now function as a kind of prosthetic brain, connecting most of humanity. But we can shrink technology even further, even down to the level of individual atoms within limits. Nanotechnology promises much, ranging from medical uses of distributing drugs such as insulin and diabetics such as myself directly inside the bloodstream, all while real-time monitoring blood sugar levels, to even construction using nanotechnological assemblers that can derive raw materials from nature and build things from them. You instruct the nanotechnological cloud to construct a crescent wrench, and you walk away. The technology then mines the needed materials from the environment and assembles the wrench, and after a time, which can never be anything close to instant due to the heat generated by the process, that would melt the nanobots, but voila, you eventually have a wrench that has been 3D printed by nanotechnology. And therein lies the pitfall. If something were to go wrong with such a technology, disaster awaits. This is the idea of the gray goo, where the nanobots run amok unchecked, eating up the raw materials of the entire Earth and making it into whatever the nanotechnology was programmed to make. Or it could be that the nanobots self-replicate and turn entire planets into themselves, causing the extinction of alien civilizations that lose control over their nanotech. But there are limits to this kind of technology. The aforementioned heat is one issue, but also complexity. The simpler the nanotech machine, the faster it can self-replicate, but generally the less capable it will be. With increasing complexity comes a slowdown of the rate of growth of the machines, though that growth by nature will still be exponential. This could give a time period where the process of self-replication can be stopped in time to save the civilization threatened by it. Possible ways to do this would be the use of an electromagnetic pulse to take out the nanotechnology, given that the shielding the nanobots would need from such a thing would add more complexity. Another option is to create a second nanotechnology designed to attack and neutralize the out-of-control one. And then there are the odd scenarios of developing technologies to avert disaster that end up being a disaster in and of themselves. Say, for example, a civilization wanted to alter their atmosphere or moderate climate change to avert extinction, so they create an advanced AI or nanotechnology to accomplish that task, only to lose control of it, and then the mitigation technology ends up causing the extinction. It has been said that climate change is an inevitability among any industrialized technological civilization, alien or us. So it could be that mitigating climate change is a great filter, with advanced enough technology, leaving a universe full of formerly inhabited planets now devoid of all life, and the only thing surviving being the technology originally devised to avert extinction. Technologies devised in a pinch to avert disaster are sometimes not well thought through, given the emergency that spawned the need for them. And now we get into the unknown and speculative science. There are also materials that may exist, or be allowed to exist in the universe, that could be extremely dangerous if ever created. This includes a hypothesized type of strange matter, a quark matter known as a strangelet. One specific feature of this type of matter, should it exist, is that it may be possible for it to convert any normal matter it comes into contact with into strange matter, meaning an entire planet could be destroyed through conversion if it came into contact with this material. So creating it could be inherently dangerous to anyone that might try. And the scary thing is, it very well might result from a simple science experiment in a laboratory in a science fiction type disastrous escape scenario. And then there is the unknown. We don't know everything about the universe. Vast areas of science remain to be discovered, and no doubt it will be full of unimaginable surprises. Within those unknown areas of nature may lie even more threats that we aren't yet aware of. It's also possible that the moment a species becomes aware of some hidden but deadly attribute of the universe, they immediately go extinct just by discovering it. Scary indeed, but it is at least plausible that any of the mentioned technologies in this video may be responsible for the Great Silence, and there may be even more we do not yet know of. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently wondering about nano cooking. Generating heat is necessary for cooking, so could you have nanotechnology moving moderately fast to generate already cooked delicious foods? Think nano toast. But I doubt it could do ice cream well, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.